thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Jesus. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Spoke away, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. I took a break, cause you breathed your life in me. Cause you have been so, so kind to me. I was your foe, still your love fought for me. Cause you have been so, so good to me, yeah. When I found a word, cause you paid it all for me, yes you did. Cause you have been so, so kind to me. Yeah. shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. Yes, no. Thank you, Jesus, for you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for you. The head that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at His feet we bow. For all to see. Yes, Jesus. 'Cause your name is victory. 'Cause all praise will rise to Christ our King. 'Cause your name is victory. All that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon that cross is now alive in me. Yeah. Yes, Jesus. 'Cause your name is victory.
and Father, Spirit, I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrecting King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. You resurrecting King is resurrecting me. Soldiers watched in vain, was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain, 'cause our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the grave.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus, you are risen. Come on.
Well, hello, I'd like to welcome you all to this online service. Thanks so much for watching and worshiping with us today. I'd like to welcome all guests that are part of this online service. Thanks for being with us today. All of our Discovery family, thank you for being with us today. All of our moms that are out there, man, this is Mother's Day. Today is all about you, man. We love you. Moms are superheroes. And right from the beginning of the service, we want to let you know that the first 25 moms that actually comment, they chat, say, hey, I'm a mom out there, we're going to send you a free $10 Starbucks gift card to your email. So happy Mother's Day to all of our moms. And you know what, I think I should like put some of our worship team on the spot this morning and just kind of ask, you know, hey, what is one word that comes to mind when you think of moms? I'm going to pick on Bree first. Bree, what's one word that comes to mind when you think of mom?
Strength.
Strength. I love that. Moms, you guys are strength for us. And Jennifer, what's one word that comes to mind when you think of mom?
Superwoman.
Moms are superwomen, superheroes. I love that. All right. We got Brandon back here on the drums, man. Good to see you, Brandon. What's one word that comes to mind when you think of mom?
Unconditional.
All right, you got to hear that?
Unconditional.
Moms, unconditional. I love it. I love it. Well, I'm going to pray, and we're going to jump into worship as we honor moms today. God, we thank you so much for Mother's Day and all that it means, and the women that help shape our lives with their strength. The moms are just always doing the things that we need, and they're super women and just unconditional, sacrificial love that moms offer us, Lord. We just thank you so much we can celebrate moms today. And God, I just pray for our time together in worship, that our hearts would engage in worship, Lord, and that the Bible, the Word of God, would transform us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's do it!
Good morning, Discovery. Let's get ready to worship Jesus this morning. Come on. Here we go!
Thank you.
is all I know, and I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Yeah, Jesus. Shame no longer has a place to hide.
Promise.
promise you sent, and great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you never failed me yet. No, Jesus, and you'll never will.
My confidence.
Jesus.
This is how I fight my battles.
So where we are, let's lift up our hands.
This is how I fight my battles.
Yeah, yeah.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
When she listens to music in the car, she dances to it.
What is something funny mommy does?
Mommy dance.
The funny dance?
The funny dance.
She sometimes does funny, really funny jokes, like, what did the bird say? Cock-a-doodle-doo! I know one said that. She says, what's a hand's favorite tree?
Oh yeah, that one.
What?
A palm tree.
Cause you have a palm. She makes a lot of funny jokes. She like to get on the horsey, I think.
I don't know. Just like messes with it.
In the morning, she'll come and wake me up, but like she'll do it in like a funny way. Like she'll throw a pillow at me, like try and talk to me. So like as I'm waking up, like I can barely understand, and she just says like funny stuff. And yeah,
she always like calls us the weirdest nicknames, and she always like teases us in a funny way and calls us all these weird names, which is kind of funny.
She takes care of me.
And you take care of me too?
She helps me do my homework also.
You always take me care of me too.
She provides
food. Let's just play video game.
Provides food for us. Hey, stop it. But we're in place right now.
Takes care of us.
Takes me places.
Gets me pizza.
If like I go somewhere or like do something, so like we go to like California, like she always like prepares me, makes sure I have everything, and she's like always there for me and just make sure like I'm set for whatever I'm going to do.
She always like provides everything for me, like if it comes to like prepping for a trip, like Dylan said, or just like providing lunch or dinner, she always just is there.
I love her because she takes care of me and she loves me a lot.
He loves me a lot too.
She loves you a lot and gets candy too, huh?
Because she takes care of me.
Oh, she takes care of you. That's right. She does take good care of you.
And Bro-Bro.
And Bro-Bro.
Because she gives us time to play video games. Because she's kind and caring for us. Because she gives us time to play video games.
She's like always there for us. She cooks us food and she takes care of us. She's probably the best mom in the world and we love her a lot. And she's always there for us when we need her.
And she just gives me snacks and she like tells me when to give me snacks. Always.
Because she takes care of me. She always listens to the stuff that we have to say.
I love my mom because she always looks out after me and like no matter what I'm doing, she'll always like text me to make sure I'm good and like sometimes when she'll make my lunches, like she'll put a note in for me. And yeah, she just does like all the small things and the big things. And I just love her for that.
I love her because she's always here for me and she always makes me laugh and she's always fun to be around. She's a really good singer and she's actually a good cook. She doesn't think she is, but she is a good cook and yeah.
Hey, all of our guests that are watching today, the Discovery family, I've got a special message this Mother's Day called Renovate My Family, Mom's Edition. But there is something here for everyone. I want to talk about Ruth and the way that the events of her life, man, they just impacted her day-to-day life. Because you can allow the events of your life to be taken over by the enemy, to be used against you, or you can actually convert them into something that God can use, in which He will use to build your future. A story is told of a builder who had employed a contractor that had renovated many, many houses throughout his life. And he was at the end of his career, just ready to retire. He was tired of renovating houses. But his boss that he worked for his whole life said, "Hey, can you just renovate one more house for me?" And the boss persisted. The guy was like, "No, no way, man. I don't want to do it." But the boss persisted and said, "Do it one more time, just as a favor." And begrudgingly, he said he would. And he looked at the plans and he really didn't want to. So he kind of went through it half-heartedly. He cut corners all over the place. If things weren't what they should be, he'd be like, "All right, it's okay, just nail it in there anyways." He used low-grade material throughout the renovation of that house. And then he goes to his boss at the end of the renovation project and said, "All right, this is my last one. I'm done. I'm retiring." To which the boss said, "Hey, just one more thing. The keys to that house you just renovated, those keys are yours. It's your house. It's my gift to you. Little did he know, he was renovating a house that would be gifted to him and he would eventually spend the rest of his life in. If he knew the house he was building was going to be for himself, do you think he would have taken more time to build it right? Man, you better believe he would. The thing is, we are building our lives, and we have the option that we can build. We're building our homes, we're renovating our homes, and we can choose to build poorly, or we can build well. And little do we know, it's for our future. God has plans for us, for our future, and he wants it to be the best, but we provide the building materials, the heart, the spirit, the attitude with which we live in our life. And you have to know this in renovating our family. It's not the events of your life that will determine your future, but how you interpret the events of your life. Because the enemy is trying to misshape your interpretation of the events of your life, to misshape how you view yourself and how you view your future. And you have to remember this, that we all have bitter cards dealt to us, but it's a matter of how you play those cards that will make a difference in the world. And we're going to learn from Ruth, that a mother that changed the world, but she was handed some pretty bitter cards. But the way she interpreted it, the way she responded, the way God used the negative events of Ruth's life would build a sterling future for her. So in Scripture, we get to see the story of a poor, impoverished widow become grandmother to Israel's greatest king, King David. And you read in the New Testament the lineage, the family lineage of the Messiah in Matthew chapter 1. Something amazing you read is that Ruth's name is actually mentioned in the family line of Jesus Christ, which means this: she was a mom and a grandma and a great grandma that would change the world. Our future starts, it begins with God's plan. And we know God's plan is good. Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 11 says this: I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. God has a great plan, but what is our part? Joshua chapter 3, verse 5, Joshua told the people this. He said, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. The word consecrate means to take something that's wholly usable to God that was not so in the past, formerly. And so you offer it to God. You give it to God. You consecrate it for God's purpose. It's the handing of something to God, and God takes it. And what God takes in his hands becomes really powerful. And it's how you see things, not the cards you've been handed. I want to tell you a story. Two prisoners were sitting on their bunks in prison. And one looked out and he saw the clear night and the stars. And he said to his bunkmate, look outside, man, it's amazing. But his bunkmate had a bad attitude. And he said, look, come on, Billy, man, you look outside and see stars. I don't see any stars. When I look out my window, all I see is those prison bars. It's funny how one person saw prison bars and the other one saw stars. And the one who saw the bars remained in prison, but the one who saw the stars, even for that moment, his heart was free. And he was no longer bound in that prison. and he chose to respond. And Ruth teaches us, it's not the bitter cards you get, it's how you play them. And Ruth tells us how to take experiences in life that may be very difficult, but to respond well. And you can play them in a way where God says, hey, I'm going to build for you a future and a hope. Even if the moment that you're in isn't good. Ruth's story starts with her mother-in-law, whose name is Naomi. She was married to Elimelech from Bethlehem. What happens is there's a famine in Israel, and he had to move out of Israel to get food for his family. He has two sons, Chilion and Mahlon, and they move down to a place called Moab. It's on the east side of the Red Sea, and Moab was, as you look in the Old Testament story, was a descendant of Lot. And you remember back to the days of Abraham and Lot. Well, Lot had a son named Moab who came down and he settled in this area, which would become called Moab. And they went down to this area to get food. And these two sons of Naomi and Elimelech, Chilion and Mahlon, would actually marry two Moabite women. Orpah, okay, that's not Oprah. Orpah and Ruth. Now, the funny thing is they get married, and within 10 years, all the husbands die. Elimelech dies. Chilion dies. Mahlon dies. All three husbands die. I don't know about you, but that starts to sound a little bit suspicious. I mean, 10 years, three dead husbands. I mean, that was some really bad cooking going on, just saying. So now you have three widows, and we're not in the days of life insurance, in those days. So they have no house, they have no money, they have no job, they have no way to sustain themselves. And Naomi speaks up and she said this, I'm going back to Bethlehem. I'm going back to Israel, to my family, my God. And you girls, you guys can go back to Moab. And Orpah actually responded to that. She said, see ya, but I wouldn't want to be ya. And she's out. She goes back to Moab. But Ruth responds in a completely different way. Even as a Moabite woman, she said, no, I'm going down with you to Bethlehem because my heart has left the gods of Moab long ago, and I serve the God of Israel. I serve the one true God. So I'm going to go back with you, Naomi. And there were some major setbacks in this situation. There were some really difficult circumstances that she is dealt, that Ruth is dealt, that Naomi is dealt. And I want to give you three perspectives of a mother who changes the world so that you and I can see and learn that God is building our futures despite what we might see in the present. And the first lesson is this: never allow downturns to become U-turns. Sooner or later, it happens to all of us. We experience a downturn. We feel like in this season of life that man, maybe we lost a family member that we love. Maybe we lose a job. Maybe we lose a friend. Maybe it's just not really very fun going through a worldwide pandemic. We experience a downturn and that we've been dealt. Listen, never allow that downturn to become a U-turn. Never let a bad hand, anybody who plays cards, know every now and then you just got to deal with a bad hand. And life sometimes gives us a bad hand that we're dealt. I love how Ruth responded. She said, I'm not going to go to Moab and serve the gods of this world. Many Bible characters faced major downturns. Perhaps the most prominent was Job. Job was completely wiped out. Man, his family was taken from him. He broke out. His health was destroyed. He just broke out in boils all over. His wife came to him and said, "You're still serving God? Look at what's happened to you." And she had just absolutely blasted him for his faith. He's like, "Why don't you curse God and die?" Wow. And Job responds in a really wonderful way. He said, "Shall we not accept good from God and not bad? Shall we not along with the bad?" And listen, we have to learn to take the bad, and we have to learn to use those moments well. It's amazing that the Bible speaks of Job, and it says, "In all of this, Job did not blame God." He was determined, regardless of what happened to him, he was going to serve his God. And you'll hear in Ruth's voice as she responds to Naomi in Ruth chapter 1, verse 16, Ruth replied, "Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God." The way you look at things, it's not the bitter cards you're handed, it's how you play them. And though we have a downturn, don't allow it to be a U-turn in your heart and in your life. Don't let it change your heart, your spirit, your attitude. Let the moment that we're in right now, let that you respond well, remembering it's not the events of your life that determine your future. It's how you define the events of your life. And one sees it in a way that, hey, God is going to bring me out of this moment. Another sees it in a way that they say, hey, you know what? I'm going to cave in because of it. I mean, Ruth loses her husband, her finances, her home. And she said, "I'm not going back to Moab. I'm not going to do a U-turn. I'm not going to, in the midst of a downturn." And she responds well in the moment, even when she's dealt a really bad hand. Ruth goes back to Bethlehem with Naomi. She's a foreigner and a widow, and the only thing that's left for Ruth to do is glean from the fields. And in that culture, you could go like behind the owners and try to glean enough wheat to actually sustain you. And many considered it actually begging. And you would go out and then sell the grain. And Ruth was willing to do this. She was willing to glean. She wasn't above that. She said, "Hey, if I have to glean, I will." Little did she know that she would end up in the field of Boaz, who would end up falling in love with her and marrying her. And they would have a son named Obed, who would give birth to a son named Jesse, who would have several sons, including the shepherd boy, becoming king of all Israel, David. And listen, if Ruth wasn't willing to glean for a season of her life, her future would have been different. But God's plan for Ruth was that she would be a mother that would change the world. God's plan was that, as she's mentioned in Matthew chapter 1, as a Moabite woman in the family lineage of Jesus Christ. That was God's plan for her. I wonder if there aren't seasons of our life where we need to be willing to glean. There are seasons of our life that, hey, we have to go through a quarantine. We have to go through an economic downturn. We have moments in our life that are trying, difficult moments. And you might be in the middle of one of those moments. I just want to encourage you today with Ruth's story, a mother that changed the world. Don't allow a downturn to become a U-turn in your faith. Let's do exactly the opposite. And number two, let's learn from a mother that changed the world to live to serve and not be served. when you unpackage this whole thing about a relationship with Jesus and following Christ, we are called to be servants of the Most High God. You read the New Testament and the apostles that wrote the New Testament, and they don't refer to themselves as men that ought to be esteemed as apostles. They don't refer to themselves as, hey, we're these mighty leaders in which everybody... No, they refer to themselves as bondservants. They actually identify themselves as being servants of Christ. They represent Christ. Philippians chapter 2. Verses 6 and 7 says this, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Listen, we are servants who are serving the purposes of God in our life. One of the great lessons that is a difficult lesson for us is humility. There are seasons of our life where perhaps we get the feeling like, hey, I'm kind of in a season of my life where I feel like I'm doing some gleaning. There are seasons of our lives that are more difficult. They're hard. And in that moment, I just want to remind you that our Savior, Jesus Christ, took on the form of a servant. He came in humility to die on a cross for you and I. And we shouldn't respond with a worldly attitude. And like say back to God, man, I can't believe you allowed this to happen to me. I can't believe you allowed my family member to get sick. I can't believe you allowed me to get sick. I can't believe that you're allowing me to go through this downturn. I lost income. I lost my job. And you're just at that place. It's a place where you and I can learn to serve. It's a place where you and I can learn humility. And we can respond to that moment in a really good way. See, I've heard it said that you can learn a lot from the tea bag. Because when you add water, you determine what comes out of a tea bag. And when you add hot water to your and my life, you see what truly comes out of us. How do you and I respond to those difficult moments? The Apostle Paul said this in Philippians chapter 4, verse 12, about the way that we respond to the moment that we're in. He said, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. The Apostle Paul was willing to glean. He said, hey, I'm content in every situation. Ruth was willing to glean. There are times in our lives God wants us to learn humility in that moment, and we choose to respond well in the difficult moments of our life. And I believe that will go on in future moments of our life to produce the biggest opportunities and perhaps the greatest moments of your life. Because it's not the cards you've been dealt. It's about how you play them in the moment that they're handed to you. And we can offer to God a usable heart, a usable spirit, a usable attitude. Or we can offer back to God unusable materials. We can respond in pride. We can respond with the self-seeking greed in those moments of our life. Ruth teaches us to do exactly the opposite. In Ruth chapter 2, verse 17 and 18, so she gleaned in the field until evening. Then she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. And she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. And she also took it out and gave Naomi what she had left after she was satisfied. Root responds well. There's a third thing we learn from a mother who changed the world. That's this: take no shortcuts. See, Ruth had an opportunity to take a shortcut like many ladies in her day would take. See, ladies that gleaned also had other activities at night. They could come and they could prostitute themselves to the men of the field. And it came with the territory for some of the ladies that gleaned that they would participate in this activity. But Ruth was different. And Ruth responded well to the moment that she was in, even though it was difficult. And it was for that very reason Boaz noticed the difference. He saw the righteousness come forth from Ruth's life. And in Ruth chapter 3, verse 10, it says this: but then Boaz said, "May you be blessed of the Lord. You have shown your last kindness to be better than the first by not going after young men, whether poor or rich." It starts with the level of respect for her, because she didn't take moral shortcuts in her life, and he ends up marrying her, and Ruth becomes the great-grandmother of David, and Ruth is in the lineage of the Messiah, the Savior, the living God. She is a mother that helped change the world. You want to hear some wisdom? We're an impatient generation of people. We've learned that, hey, we want it right now. And I know I do in my life. A lot of times I'm just in a hurry. I just want it quickly. There are moments in our life where we need to slow down. And God says to us in that moment, "I want you to wait on me." And we always shouldn't be looking for a shortcut. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3 says this: "For the vision is yet for an appointed time, and it hastens to the end. It will not deceive or disappoint. Though it tarry," which means carry on, "though it tarry, wait earnestly for it, because it will surely come. It will not be behindhand on its appointed day." Listen, God shows up on time every time in the God's plan for our life. And the vision for our life will happen at the appointed time, because God, in His time, in His control, in His sovereignty, is the God who sits on the throne. Listen, He has an appointed time, and it's not too far behind. So we don't have to take shortcuts morally, ethically, spiritually, intellectually. Because as you learn in this world in which we live to take a lot of shortcuts in your life, morally, spiritually, it will lead to one thing. It'll lead to regrets. And God has so much in store for us as we offer ourselves to God, as we consecrate ourselves to God. And we specifically must not allow the downturn that we might be in to become a U-turn. We must live our lives to serve and not be served. We should learn in our life not to take shortcuts, because there's an appointed time with God. And God will say, "This is great building material with which I can use to build your future." Ruth did it, and she was a mother that changed the world. And it is a mother that teaches us today, because that's what you moms do. You teach us. And you have so much wisdom to impart and offer. And you and I have the chance today to offer God the best materials possible, and God will take care of our future. And that's the story of Ruth, a mother who changed the world. And I just want to encourage everyone today that in the moment you're in your life, listen, don't let this downturn in our economy and in our world get the best of you. Let it be an upturn in your faith. Let it be an upturn in your life, that in what happens to you, you're going to respond well to this moment and give God building materials, because in the next season of our life, God is renovating our homes. He's renovating your and my life. And we know the plan He has for us. It's plans to prosper us. It's plans for hope. It's plans for a future. And we can trust God as we move forward with that. Let's respond well. I want to wish all of our moms just a wonderful Mother's Day today. Have a great time with family and enjoy your day, because you're superheroes to us and we love you. I want to pray. God, we thank you that we can come to the Bible today and learn from a mom that changed the world, because moms just impart wisdom and they have so many good things. They do so many good things for us so selflessly. And God, I just pray, Lord Jesus, that we would learn from Ruth today these powerful lessons, and we would just live them out, Lord Jesus, that every person watching this online service today would look forward in their life, not from a heart that is overcome, not from a heart that is beaten down, not from a heart that's downtrodden, not from we look forward and we have fear. No, we don't look forward with fear. We look forward with faith, God, because you're a God that is overcome. And God, we just believe that your vision will happen. Your plan will succeed in its appointed time. But in the process, Lord, if you desire to teach us humility in this current moment or this current season, if you desire for us to have a season in which we learn to glean, if you have a season for us, God, in which, Lord Jesus, we can grow during the tough times, we're going to respond well. We're going to respond well to this moment, Lord Jesus. And I pray that we would have a heart, a spirit, and an attitude that prevails. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, hey, Pastor Andy has some next steps for you. Thanks for joining us for this online service. Happy Mother's Day.
Hey there, Discovery family. Thank you so much for tuning in and participating in our worship service today. Pastor Ben was so righteous now. Jesus is still calling people to follow him. Now, if you haven't made that choice, or maybe you've drifted away from him, today is the day that you can respond to the God that made you and loves you. Romans 10, 8-11 says it this way, and I love how it says it. It says, the message is very close at hand. It's on your lips and in your heart. And that message is the very message about faith that we preach. If you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God. And it is by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. As the scriptures tell us, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now, I think that scripture is speaking to a lot of people right now. In fact, if you're ready to follow that scripture and accept Jesus Christ as your Lord, you can do that right now. If the Holy Spirit's speaking to you and wants you to respond in that way, I'd invite you to pray with me and repeat after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I turn from my sins and invite you to come into my heart and life, and I want to trust you and follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Now go ahead and email us at prayerdiscoverycc.org to follow up with one of the believers and leaders here at Discovery to continue and see what your next steps in your life with Jesus could be. Now, if God spoke to you in any other way through the ministry here at Discovery, maybe it was through the message, the music, really anything, we would really like you to just reach out to us, whether it's through that email, Facebook, whatever it is, and just share your blessing with us. let us know, you know, what God is doing through our ministry. Now, for those of you that call Discovery Community Church home, we want to invite you to go to the church's website at this time and give back to the Lord financially some of what He has blessed you with. This is actually a really great time for those of us that consider ourselves part of the Discovery Church family to invest in what God is doing in His kingdom right here through the ministry of this church. Now, stay strong out there, and remember, just because we aren't meeting in person doesn't mean that we're not together in spirit. I'll end with some encouraging words from the Bible in Colossians 2:5. It says this, "For though I am far away from you, my heart is with you, and I rejoice that you are living as you should, and that your faith in Christ is strong." God bless.